There is a place lies north where Germany is bounded, where stands in the rigid sea Thule, to which there do lie opposite infamous rocks, the mariners that fright, and a huge stony gulf which fiercely knocks the roaring waves against the ragged rocks. These, if we may give credit unto fame, were called Orkneys, from a Greek name.
I first came to Orkney in 1970 for a holiday like any other tourist. The sounds are the natural sounds of seabirds, of the wind. These things are very important, and these create ideal environmental conditions in which one can work uninterruptedly, and one's ears, as it were, become completely tuned in to these very fine, small, beautiful sounds. And I suppose living here, exploring these new sound experiences, has enabled me to explore parallel new regions for me of musical experience. Immediately captured by the atmosphere and the magic of the place. And apart from the people, which I suppose must be the first consideration, it's a sense of rightness of place and rightness of atmosphere, and most particularly for a composer, the rightness of the sound.
Easily uttered. We utter it lightly who know least about it. A vast ancient terror is locked in the name like energy in an atom. Sailors, explorers, fishermen know this. Women who stand on headlands,
then my great grandfather was lost, both at sea. One was a boating accident, the other was just coming across the Sound from ferry home to ferry. The tide came in, swept the feet under the old man. He lost his leg.
Green echoes that I tell you, but arched aboon them spreads a boundless sky, ripening their crops, and round them lie lang miles o' moorland hill. Beyond the cliff tap glimmers o' the sun, the far horizon's bright infinity, and I can look out o'er the sea when my day's work is done. The solitudes o' land and sea assuage me quenchless thirst for freedom. Unconfined, with independent heart and mind, howled I me heritage.
Hann átti svo mikinn drykkjuskála að engi var annar jafn mikill í Orkneyjum. Sveinn hafði á vorum starfan í Seise Saga, to spend the winter at home, where he always kept a household of no less than 80 men. Indeed, he had the largest drinking hall in the whole of Orkneyjum og Írland og kom heim eftir mitt sumar. Það kallaði hann Vorvíking. Þá var hann heima til þessir akrar voru uppskornir.
The first Orkney peoples can only be seen darkly. A few figures on a moorland against the sky, between twilight and night. They are beyond the reach of legend even. Archaeologists describe a Mediterranean folk who committed themselves to the sea. They steered their boats through the straits northward. Beyond the savage bulk of Cape Wrath, there was empty ocean, until in a summer dawn they saw the Orkneys like sleeping whales. There they made landfall. Hardly a thing is known about these first Orkney men, if they were the first Orkney men, apart from the monuments they left behind them, the huge stones of Maes Howe and Brogger, and the pastoral village of Scarabray in the west. History can tell nothing, not a word or a name comes out of the silence. There are a few ambiguous scratches on a wall at Scarabray.
I remember saying that when we were bairns that
we had most of our toys. We had boats. They were made of wood, paper, or shags, that's the yellow flag.
Yes.
We had tops, which were made from the reels or the perms. Slings were made with pieces of leather and string. And we loved hen dollars.
Hamnaboo. My father passed with his penny letters through closes opening and shutting like legends, when barbarous with gulls, Hamnaboo's morning broke on the salt and tar steps.
Oh, the crew, the fairy folk ran down to do what they could, and some of the crew thought that they were savages and jumped in the sea to swim away, and the two of them was lost. But the rest got ashore, and the story goes that the old captain came up to Holland, the biggest farm there, and the old lady was sitting spinning, and he just took a hold of the wheel and set it in the fire.
Sleep do me piri boni budo.
building, and then the incomers came in, and they were the real fairy folk, and they seemed to get tired of them. After the war, then, it just made a general evacuation.
Burnmouth, the door hangs from a broken hinge, and the fire is out. The windows of shore, empty sockets, and the hearth coldness. At Bunatun, the small drains are choked. Thrushes sing in the chimney. Stars shine through the roof beams of scar. No flame is needed to warm ghost and nettle and rat. Green Hill is sunk in a new bog. No kneeling woman blows red wind through squares of ancient turf. The moss is a slow fire of rust eats the cold iron. The sheep drift through Rumen all winter. Sheep and snow blanch fleetingly the black stone. The poor and the good fires are all quenched. Now, cold angel, keep the valley from the bedlam and cinders of a black Pentecost.
Around us a muted din of fiddles and feet, circlings of bread and ale. This room we are in at the seaward side is still. I turn a cold sheet. Midnight. The shoal drifts like a host of souls unborn along the shore. The tide sets from the west. His salt hand shifts from tumults of thigh and breast to the hard curve of an oar.
Poetry, art, music thrive on these constants. They gather into themselves a huge scattered diversity of experience and reduce them to patterns, so that, for example, in a poem all voyages, past, present and future, become the voyage, and all battles the battle, and all feasts the feast. The symbol becomes a jewel, enduring and flaming throughout history. Therefore, all our little journeys and fights and suffers that seem so futile once they are over are drenched with a symbol and retain a richness they never had while they were being experienced. Men handle the jewel and know themselves enriched.
lumbering horses in the steady plough on the bay of fields. I wonder why, just now, they seem terrible, so wild and strange, like magic power on the stony grange. Perhaps some childish hour has come again, when I watch, fearful, through the blackening rain, that hooves like pistons in an ancient mill. It fades, and I must pine again for that dread country crystalline, where the blank field and the still standing tree were bright and fearful presences to me.
We had a wedding, and then it was a very happy occasion. On my granny's day, they used to sing to the dance music. They used to sort of have tunes, you know, what they sang without words. The old granny used to say it, they used to put a turtle in the tongue and sing it, you know, long before my time, so there's always fiddles in my time.
Sigurd, Earl of Orkney, were lying at anchor in Kirkhope in the south of Hoy, when a small weather-scarred fleet entered the bay from the Pentland Firth. The captain was a Norwegian called Olaf Tryggvason, who was now returning home after a very strange experience. During his cruise, he had been baptized into Christianity in the Isles of Scilly. Their exchange of courtesies was brief. "You will either become a Christian now," said Olaf Tryggvason, "you and all your men, or I will comb your islands with sword and fire." So, just before the year AD 1000, Orkney became officially Christian.
The 20 brothers of Einhallow have made a figure of Our Lady. From red stone they carved her and set her on a headland. There Spindrift salts her feet. At dawn the brothers sang this: "Blessed Lady, since midnight we have done three things. We have bent hooks, we have patched a sail, we have sharpened knives." Yet the little silver brothers are afraid. "Bid them come to our net, show them our fire, our fine round plates. Per Christum Dominum Nostrum, look mildly on our hungers."
Saint Magnus, Earl of Orkney, was a man of extraordinary distinction, tall, with a fine, intelligent look about him. He was a man of strict virtue, successful in war, wise, eloquent, generous, and magnanimous, open-handed with money and sound with advice, and altogether the most popular of men. Shortly after Earl Hakon came to power in Orkney, Magnus, the son of Earl Erland, returned north from Scotland to claim his inheritance. When the kinsman had been ruling the earldom for some time, it so happened, as it often does, that malicious tongues set out to destroy their friendship, and it was to Hakon that the more luckless men were drawn, for he was very envious of the popularity and splendor of his cousin Magnus. Earl Magnus called around him all the people he knew to be the best-natured and likeliest to improve matters between him and his cousin. And when he was ready, off he went to Eggleston. Once it had been decided that the saintly Earl Magnus was to die, Hakon told his standard-bearer, Ofeig, to do the killing, but he refused angrily. So Hakon ordered his cook, Lifolf, to kill Magnus. Lifolf started to weep out loud. "Stand in front of me and strike me hard on the head," said Magnus. "It's not fitting for a chieftain to be beheaded like a thief." "Take heart, poor fellow. I've prayed that God grant you his mercy." With that he crossed himself and stooped to receive the blow. The place where this happened was rocky and overgrown with moss, but soon God revealed how worthy Earl Magnus was in his eyes, for the spot where he was killed turned into a green field. In this way God showed that it was in the cause of justice that Magnus died, and that he had reached the verdant fields of paradise, called the land of the living. What did they bring to the saint?
The shepherds a fleece. That winter many lambs were born in the snow.
What did the dark ones bring?
To Magnus the tinkers have brought a new bright can. Their hammers beat all night.
Glimmer back in my skull.
one foot in Eden still I stand, and look across the other land. The world's great day is growing late, yet strange these fields that we have planted, so long with crops of love and hate. Time's handiworks by time are haunted, and nothing now can separate the corn and tares compactly grown, the armorial weed in stillness bound about the stalk. These are our own. Evil and good stand thick around in the fields of charity and sin, where we shall lead our harvest in. Yet still from Eden springs a root as clean as on the starting day. Time takes the foliage and the fruit and burns the archetypal leaf to shapes of terror and of grief scattered along the winter way. But famished field and blackened tree bear flowers in Eden never known. Blossoms of grief and charity bloom in these darkened fields alone. What had Eden ever to say of hope and faith and pity and love, until was buried all its days, and memory found its treasure trove? Strange blessings, never in paradise, fall from these beclouded skies.